Morning, committee will come to order. The House Armed Services Committee meets today to receive testimony from the commanders of U.S. Central Command, General James Mattis, U.S. Special Operations Command, Admiral William McCraven, U.S. Transportation Command, General William Fraser. Thank you all for being with us here today. Much has changed since we last received testimony from your respective commands. We've withdrawn all forces from Iraq, continued to disrupt al-Qaeda and target its senior leadership around the world. The President has begun the withdrawal of the surge forces in Afghanistan. Tensions with Iran continue to increase, and a new defense strategy has been released that demands increased power projection and a more globally balanced, agile, and persistent special operations force. Still, even more significant events are on the horizon. Reports in the press continue to speculate that the administration may be prepared to announce an additional withdrawal of forces and a change to an advisory strategy for Afghanistan in advance of the NATO summit in Chicago in May. I see little strategy in such a plan, if it exists, but rather a political calculus that will ultimately protract the war in Afghanistan, increase casualties, and further erode confidence among our allies and credibility among our adversaries. Meanwhile, Iran is showing little willingness to curtail its nuclear program. In spite of the tightening brace of economic sanctions imposed at the insistence of Congress, although the Supreme Leader may not yet have made the decision to build a nuclear weapon, time is running out for Iran to responsibly join the international community. I agree with the recent recommendations of the Bipartisan Policy Center Task Force on Iran, led by former Senator Charles Robb and retired General Charles Wald, including their warning that the United States must immediately shift to a triple-track strategy: diplomacy, sanctions, and visible, credible preparations for a military operation of last resort. But let me be clear, this isn't casual talk of war. A nuclear Iran is a serious problem that the Commander-in-Chief should be discussing with the American people and our allies every day. And it must be confronted with all elements of national power, not simply an outstretched hand. As for Special Operations Command, I alluded to the changes envisioned by the new defense strategy. SOCOM is truly being asked to do more with less. The command's budget was modestly reduced, but it's expected to continue its 5% growth rate for the next 3 years. Furthermore, all signs point to a heavy demand signal for our Special Operations Force in U.S. Central Command, where more than 80% of all deployed Special Operations Forces are right now. In Afghanistan alone, Special Operations Forces will continue to be stretched dangerously thin as conventional and enabling forces draw down. Although only 8% of the total force in Afghanistan, Special Operations Forces are increasingly leaned on at the local level through the village stability operations and Afghan local police programs, and at the national level with ongoing counterterrorism and direct action missions in conjunction with our Afghan partners. And now, with the potential to have a new three-star soft general or flag officer at ISAF command levels, I'm increasingly concerned that our Special Operations Forces may be forced into an overburdened role if our conventional forces withdraw too fast and without a sound transition to the Afghan National Security Forces. Finally, we speculated last year what might happen should Pakistan close supply routes to Afghanistan, and now we know. Transcom has been doing incredible work to make sure that our troops in Afghanistan continue to get what they need in spite of the current downturn in U.S.-Pakistan relations. Looking forward, Transcom will be challenged to provide the lift and pre-position stocks necessary to fulfill the vision laid out in the new defense strategy. It seems to me that an increasing emphasis on the Asia-Pacific and increasingly maritime theater in the Middle East will demand more lift, refueling, and pre-positioned assets, not less. Yet the President's budget request reduces our capacity in each of these areas. This topic warrants further oversight by this committee, and I look forward to your testimony on these matters and more. Ranking Member Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank all three of you gentlemen for being here this morning and for your great service to our country. We have the Central Command, Special Operations Command, Transportation Command, three critical components of our entire national security strategy. I think this will be a very informative hearing. Look forward to your testimony and your answers to the questions of the members. In CENTCOM, we seem to have, you know, not quite all of the world's problems gathered in one place, but I'm sure to General Mattis, it seems like that at times. Certainly a very challenging area. For our committee, Afghanistan continues to be job one. That is where our troops are actively engaged in a war. We want to make sure that the strategy is working there and that we have a plan going forward. And then most importantly, we're providing everything that you need to make sure that our troops can do the job and the tasks that they've been given in that critically important region. But certainly Afghanistan is not the only issue. We are curious to hear how the relationship with Pakistan continues to impact what's going on in Afghanistan and the larger problems in the region. That certainly has been a very problematic relationship. You know, the classic can't live with them, can't live without them situation, but I am mindful of the fact that we need to try to maintain whatever relationship we can with Pakistan. It is a dangerous part of the world. Whatever help we can get from them, we need, and where we can't get help, we need to figure out what we have to do in order to meet the national security challenges that we have in that region. But all of that adds up to the fact that we cannot simply walk away from Pakistan. We need to find a way to make that relationship work, and your insights on that would be very helpful to this committee. As the chairman mentioned, there are other problems in the region, in Syria and Iran. So overall, it's a very challenging command that you have, and we thank you for your leadership. Admiral McCraven, we thank you for everything SOCOM has done. It's been an amazing set of accomplishments over the course of the last few years, most notably, of course, taking out Osama bin Laden with an incredible precision and talent. It was exactly the way I think the special operations folks envisioned the development of SOCOM, you know, way back in 1980 when we first started to rethink what we needed in a special operations force. It was, you know, just an incredible accomplishment. We thank you for that, but certainly not the only one. All across the globe, Al-Qaeda is on the run and in trouble because of the pressure that our military and our intelligence services are putting on them. And SOCOM, as you like to say, is at the tip of the spear on all of that. It's been an incredible string of successes, and without a doubt, it's contributed to the fact that we've not had an attack here in the U.S. If you are a member of Al-Qaeda, whether you're in Pakistan, Yemen, Somalia, wherever, you're forced to spend the bulk of your time wondering when a missile might come down on you from nowhere. And I gotta believe that makes it vastly more difficult to do what you're trying to do, and we thank you for that great leadership. We also want to thank Admiral Olson and some of the other predecessors. A plan was put in place 5-6 years ago to grow the Special Operations Forces to meet the very challenges that we saw. I guess I would disagree with the chairman a little bit. You're not doing more with less. You're doing more with more. It's just that the more that you have to do perhaps outstrips the more that you're getting in terms of supplies, and you're doing a great job of it. We appreciate that. And also, most importantly, you know, there was concern when all of this started because the quality of the Special Operations Forces is critical. We don't simply, you can't just pick people up off the streets and make them into special operators. And you guys have done an amazing job of training them and making sure that as the force has grown, the quality has been maintained. So we thank you for that, and we look forward to hearing from you how we can continue to support your efforts. And of course, none of this happens without Transportation Command. That's how all of the troops, the equipment gets to where it needs to be and when. The complexity of your job, General Fraser, is something I don't think most people appreciate, and you've done it amazingly well. And we've had incredible supply chains, incredible ability to get, you know, our troops the support they need when they need it. You know, obviously the two challenges are the ones that the chairman mentioned. One, how do we continue to provide the supplies in Afghanistan that we need, given the challenges in Pakistan? You've done an amazing job of making that work. I want to hear more about how that's going. And then as we do lay out the new strategy with the new set of equipment that's going to be provided for over the course of the next decade, how does that fit into your long-term plans? What do we need to do to make sure the strategy works? I will again emphasize and thank all of you all participated in the strategy review. It was a comprehensive approach to look at our national security needs and say, what should the strategy be? We've had the debate on this committee, and I suspect we'll continue to have the debate, about what role the shrinking budget played in that strategy. Was it the strategy that drove it, or was it the budget that drove it? I always say, obviously, it was a little bit of both. Every strategy ever developed in any situation had to at least partially factor in the resources available to implement it. But I think taking the approach that you all did, which was, let's look at the strategy, figure out what we need to do, and then take another look and say, how can we make this work within this budget environment, was the exact right approach. And the strategy that's been laid out makes sense. I wish we had more money. I wish we had more money for a lot of things. We're having a big debate right now about passing a transportation bill here. And the big debate there is we don't have enough money to do what people would like to do. We're going to have many challenges in many areas, but our fiscal situation is what it is. It's incredibly important. We cannot be a debtor nation forever. Our deficits can, in fact, explode to the point where they jeopardize our national security. So that has to be at least part of the conversation. And I think the national security apparatus in our country did a really good job of looking at those confined resources and still coming up with a strategy that meets the national security priorities of this nation. I thank all of you for doing that. I look forward to your testimony. And thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. General Mattis.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Smith, members of the committee, and thank you for this opportunity to discuss the U.S. Central Command region. I have submitted a written statement and request it be accepted for the record.
Without objection, so ordered.
It's my privilege to appear today alongside two admired leaders, Admiral Bill McCraven and General Will Fraser. Special Operations Command and Transportation Command have been key enablers to our operations in Central Command, and I am grateful for these officers' personal support. Let me begin with what I see today in the Central Region. The Arab awakening is manifesting differently in each country. While we may hope for and certainly will firmly support efforts for more democratic governments, the awakening's origins are not necessarily a rush for democracy. Rather, this awakening stems from breakdown in the social contract between governments and their people. Unjust or unresponsive regimes have fallen or are in the throes of falling, as is the case in Syria. However, the transition to a democratic government is never easy, as we see in Egypt. Further, it is not clear what the resulting governments across the region will look like. Challenges remain beyond the promise of the Arab awakening. Iran and its surrogates continue to orchestrate violence worldwide, as evidenced by its plot to kill the Saudi ambassador here in Washington, D.C. Iran represents the most significant regional threat to stability and security. Its reckless behavior and bellicose rhetoric have created a high potential for miscalculation. While we've made security gains in the fight against terrorists, the threat remains. Al-Qaeda and associated groups continue to kill innocents from the Levant to Yemen and are adapting in the face of U.S. pressure. While we maintain our pressure on the enemy, we are nesting our military efforts inside four broad U.S. diplomatic objectives for the region. First, we support each country's political reform to adapt at their own pace. Second, support for economic modernization that provides the people ownership of their future. Third, a renewed pursuit of Middle East peace, recognizing the status quo is simply not sustainable. Finally, we stand firmly with our friends and we support regional security, territorial integrity of sovereign nations, and the free flow of commerce. As the military commander for the Central Region, my overarching goal is to prevent another conflict. We seek to deter those with hostile intent. And should deterrence prove unsuccessful, we provide military options to the president. As our president has said, our strong presence in the Middle East endures, and the United States will never waver in defense of our allies, our partners, or our interests. The military challenge will be determining how we retain a sustainable presence and operational flexibility in a fiscally constrained environment. Although we are withdrawing ground forces from the region, we are not withdrawing our support for longtime allies and partners, nor are we pulling back our commitment from a region that too many times has taken a commitment of American blood and treasure to restore stability. Through persistent military-to-military engagement, our troops reassure our friends and temper adversary intentions. Security cooperation activities such as foreign military sales, international military education and training, security force training, multinational exercises are cost-effective means for building our friends' defensive capabilities, allowing us to operate in concert with allies and friends and to rapidly respond in times of need. A sustained joint presence with a pronounced naval character, supported by embarked troops, agile special operations forces, strong aviation elements, and an expeditionary Army and Marine Corps demonstrates our joint commitment to our allies, underwrites regional stability, familiarizes our forces with the theater, and builds partner abilities to protect themselves, all while providing timely response to crises. There are some other key needed capabilities that we have. We need improved counter-IED efforts even now for all the effort we've put into this. We need them to protect our troops from a pervasive threat that extends well beyond Afghanistan. Information operations and voice programs to counter adversary information and recruiting on the internet. Improved ISR assets that enable us to locate an elusive enemy and intelligence expertise to support deployed elements. We also need specific resources that are vital to the Afghanistan campaign. Coalition support funds, the Commander's Emergency Response Program, Afghanistan Infrastructure Fund, and Reintegration Authority enable us to meet urgent humanitarian and infrastructure needs of a population that is increasingly today secured by its own forces, forces we have been building and training through the Afghan Security Forces Fund. In conclusion, I appreciate the essential resources you provide, which enable us to carry out the strategy assigned. We ask only for what we need, and what we request is critical as we carry out the transition in Afghanistan and continue on course to achieve our desired strategic end state there by December 2014, as laid out at the NATO conference in Lisbon. Thanks to congressional support and thanks to the sacrifices of our military families, our forces represent America's awesome determination to stand by our friends, maintain regional stability in defense of our values and our interests. I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you, Admiral McRaven.
Good morning, Chairman McKeon, Ranking Member Smith, and distinguished members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today and represent the extraordinary men and women of the United States Special Operations Command. It is an honor to command the world's finest Special Operations Force, a force serving side by side with our broader military and interagency teammates. And I'm proud to appear today with my friends and teammates, General Jim Mattis and General Will Frazier. With your permission, sir, I'll submit my written posture statement for the record and open with some brief remarks.
Without objection, so ordered.
This morning, I'd like to provide you an overview of SOF's role in addressing our nation's ongoing and emerging security challenges. Secretary Panetta recently outlined how he viewed the future joint force. He called for low-cost, lean, technologically advanced, agile, responsive, innovative, efficient, and effective forces able to address a variety of challenges and adversaries. As I read those characteristics, I'm struck at how accurately they describe your Special Operations Forces and what we bring to the military arsenal. Special Operations Forces have had a tremendous impact on our nation's security, and never more so than during the last 10 years of war. Since 9/11, our force has doubled in size, now at 66,000. Our budget has tripled, and the number of soft deployed forces has quadrupled to meet the emerging demands. However, even with that growth, our $10.4 billion budget in fiscal year 13 still comprises only 1.7% of the total DoD budget. Simply put, SOF remains relevant, in high demand, and offers an unparalleled return on the nation's investment. As we evaluate today's rapidly evolving strategic landscape, it is clear that the demand for special operations capability will remain high. Our near-term focus is on winning the current fight against violent extremism. First and foremost, we will sustain our efforts in Afghanistan in support of ISAF by continuing the application of SOF's direct and indirect approach. The direct approach, lethal and precise, continues to degrade extremist leadership and their facilitation networks. The indirect approach, which I believe offers the greatest opportunity for victory, builds security and governance through efforts such as the village stability operations and development of the Afghan security forces. Both the direct and indirect approaches continue to have daily, positive impacts on ISAF strategy. Our sacrifice and effort in Afghanistan has been tremendous, and we continue to make this our highest priority. In addition to our efforts in Afghanistan, we also strive to maintain persistent presence globally. Today, U.S. Special Operations Forces are in 78 countries around the world supporting U.S. policy objectives. In the Pacific, Africa, Latin America, Europe, and other regions, SOF's unique skills, cultural knowledge, and ability to work with partners creates effects far above our relatively small numbers. All of these international engagements are done with the complete support and the approval of the respective geographic combatant commanders and the chiefs of mission. In addition to our focus on winning the current fight, I am committed to strengthening our support to the geographic combatant commanders by reinforcing and enabling their theater special operations commands. As you know, the theater special operations commands are sub-unified commands of the GCCs and provide the regional commanders his special operations capability. As a force provider for those soft capabilities, USSOCOM will ensure theater special operations commands have the human capital, the capability, and the soft expertise to meet the GCC's requirements. Another important aspect of soft's utility to the GCCs is our ability to partner with other national softs. Since the establishment of service special operations forces in the 1960s and then USSOCOM in 1987, our relationship with our allied partner forces around the world has strengthened each nation's soft and each nation's ability to deal with their own security problems. We must continue to build these relationships wherever possible. To win the current fight and strengthen our support to geographic combatant commanders, it will be necessary to ensure our force and their families remain strong. My predecessor, Admiral Eric Olson, established a task force to examine the fraying around the edges in our soft community. We confirmed that a decade of war, coupled with a consistently high demand signal for soft, has exerted a physical and emotional stress on our force and families. I am committed to taking care of our people with the best support we can provide. I have put a general officer and my command sergeant major in charge of preservation of the force and families. They are empowered to implement innovative solutions across the SOCOM enterprise to improve the well-being of our warriors and their families. In conclusion, the demands for SOF will not end in the foreseeable future. With your strong advocacy, we will continue to sustain a world-class special operations capability, thereby providing the nation a decisive edge in addressing the challenges that affect us today and will undoubtedly emerge tomorrow. It is an honor to appear before you today as the commander of the United States Special Operations Command. You can take pride in what the men and women of special operations are accomplishing around the world each and every day. Thank you for your continued support, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you, General Fraser.
Good morning, Chairman McKinn, Ranking Member Smith, and distinguished members of this committee. It is my distinct privilege to be here with you today representing the United States Transportation Command. We are a total force team of approximately 150,000 men, women, military, and civilians dedicated to deploying, sustaining, and then returning home our nation's most precious resource, our men and women in uniform. United States Transportation Command is a lean, dynamic organization which plays a critical role in supporting our joint force around the world. I am indeed honored and privileged to be joined here today with my good friends, General Jim Mattis and Admiral Bill McRaven. During 2011, the United States Transportation Command added a new command, the Joint Enabling Capabilities Command, led by Rear Admiral Scott Sterney. We added it to our component command leadership team, which is comprised of Air Mobility Command, led by General Ray Johns, Military Sealift Command, led by Rear Admiral Mark Busby, and Surface Deployment and Distribution Command, led by Major General Kevin Leonard. Over the last month, I have witnessed firsthand the spirit and the ingenuity of our subordinate commands during my travels throughout the United States, Central Asia, Afghanistan, the Pacific, and Antarctica, just to name a few. This past year has been particularly challenging, as our team of active duty, guard, reserve, civilian servants, merchant mariners, and commercial partners maintained an unusually high operations tempo, supporting combat operations, sustainment efforts, humanitarian relief, and crisis action responses, both at home and abroad. These efforts, from the evacuation of Japan following the devastating earthquake and tsunami, to the supporting the warfighter in Afghanistan, to our withdrawal from Iraq at the end of 2011, were all made possible by the amazing United States Transportation Command professionals who are committed to ensuring our joint force maintains global logistics dominance. As we enter a very challenging fiscal environment, focusing on capabilities which are needed for the 21st century, as defined in the President's Defense Strategy, our challenge is to continue to find fiscally responsible efficiencies to deliver the required capability to the combatant commanders. United States Transportation Command strongly supports this transition and will remain focused on supporting our forces around the world. This will not be an easy task. The new strategic guidance requires a military that is smaller and leaner, while at the same time being more agile, flexible, and ready. Having an integrated distribution system will be important to our nation, and United States Transportation Command will meet the challenges of this new environment. We will continue to build our relationships with the interagency and with other non-governmental organizations, commercial and international partners. Together, we will ensure our nation's ability to project national military power and be able to confront other national challenges anywhere and anytime. Since taking command last fall, I have been amazed to see the unique capabilities that are inherent in the command, and I could not be prouder of the United States Transportation Command team and our partners. No one in the world can match our nation's deployment and distribution capability. And the foundation of this enterprise is the enthusiasm, the dedication, and efficiency of the United States Transportation Command team. Chairman McKeon, Ranking Member Smith, and all the members of this committee, I want to thank you for your continued superb support of United States Transportation Command and all our men and women in uniform. I am grateful for the opportunity to appear before the committee today. I do ask that my written statement be submitted for the record. I look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Without objection, so ordered. Thank you for your statements, General Mattis. I mentioned the report of the Bipartisan Policy Center in my opening statement. I'd like to get your thoughts on their recommendations in the context of asking about your satisfaction with our ability to respond to an Iranian scenario. The BPC emphasized that the United States must be clear that we're willing to prevent a nuclear Iran, which includes making visible and credible preparations for a U.S. military option, including maintaining two carrier-sized groups and deploying an additional mine countermeasures squadron to the area, conducting broad exercises with regional allies, prepositioning U.S. military supplies, and augmenting the credibility of Israeli threat by bolstering its ability, its capability to strike Iran's program. They suggest that if such pressure fails, the U.S. should consider quarantining refined petroleum imports into Iran and ultimately to be capable of an effective surgical strike on Iranian nuclear and military facilities. What is your assessment of these recommendations?
Chairman, I read the report, and I believe that I have the forces, to include some of the specific forces that they outlined in the report. I also have significantly more forces than they highlight. We are conducting with our allies, partners, friends in the region, numerous exercises, quiet in many cases, but they are very obvious to our friends across the water. As far as prepositioning of equipment, I have prepositioned equipment in place for Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marines. And I think we are in a very credible position in terms of offering the President options should he need to exercise them.
Are you satisfied with your current authorities to respond to an Iranian crisis?
Absolutely, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Admiral McRaven, your request for fiscal year 2013 is $10.4 billion, which is approximately $100 million less than the fiscal year 2012 authorized levels. As I said in my own opening statement, you're truly being asked to do more with less, since the size of your force will continue to grow to 71,000 by fiscal year 2015. Where are you assuming the most risk in your budget request?
Sir, fortunately, the FY13 budget took care of special operations pretty well, as you know. When you take a look at where we took our cuts, or where we recommended our cuts to the Secretary and to the President, was in our light submersible program, which we have kind of postponed, but we have additional submersible programs that frankly will cover down on that capability, and we have delayed some of our non-standard aviation. So I'm very comfortable with the FY13 budget as it stands now, sir. I think, again, it has done a good job of protecting the critical capability that SOF brings to the military arsenal, particularly our people. As you mentioned, sir, we will grow to 66,000 this year, and if the budget slope stays as programmed, up to 71,000 by fiscal year 15.
Since your force relies heavily on all of the other services, how are the cuts to the services, the other services, impacting on your overall growth and operational readiness?
So right now, I would say it's a little too early to tell. Those cuts have come in place this year, but we'll see that that service degradation over time. What I will tell you, though, is that the service chiefs and I talk pretty routinely. They understand that that special operations is not special operations without the support of the services, and I get fantastic support from the Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marine Corps. So both the personal relationships I have with the service chiefs and the professional relationships between SOCOM and the services, I'm very confident that that we'll do fine as the services draw down a little bit.
Thank you. We haven't, as we get into the subcommittee hearings and markups, we'll find out better what these cuts and what these impacts will be across all the different programs. I doubt that we just take the President's budget and rubber stamp it. We'll be going through all of these things at those levels, and that'll give us better information as we move forward. General Fraser, in response to the budget cuts and the new defense strategy, the Air Force plans to retire 27 C-5As, bringing the total strategic lift to 274. The Air Force will also retire 65 C-130H1s and divest all of the program 38 C-27J aircraft, reducing our tactical lift force structure to 318. What's the required strategic lift to meet our current wartime requirements?
Chairman, thank you very much. The planned reductions are reductions that I support based on analysis that we have done. As you know, we completed a mobility capabilities requirement study 16, but that was based on a different strategy and a different requirement, different scenarios. We now have a new strategy. We've evaluated that strategy and taken a look at the force structure that has been proposed with the strategic lift and are comfortable that it is manageable and will be able to support it as far as the combatant commander requirements go. I would also note, though, that this is a more modernized force. When I look at the strategic airlift piece of this, this is principally about our outsized and oversized cargo. And the requirement there and that what they are reducing to will actually enable us to have greater capability and capacity. And what I'm saying is with a modernized C-17ER, extended range force, coupled with 52 C-5Ms, which are modernized C-5Ms, actually give us more capability and capacity in the sense that we are able to support the scenarios of which we're given against. The A models are less mission capable. They can't carry as much. They're also only meeting a mission capability rate of about 55%. The M's are going to be about 75%, and that's what we are looking forward to in the future with greater capacity and capability. I'd give you a real-world example. The A models are not able to do the polar overflight. The M models can, and they can carry a load of over 100,000 pounds. You cannot do that with the A's. So there's an efficiency, there's a capability, there's a capacity there that will enable us to still meet the requirements. The 130s you mentioned are also in the same boat in the sense that it's going to be a modernized force. It's going to be an optimized legacy force of H's also a greater number of J's that they have laid, the C-130 J's that they've laid in. And so that will enable us to be able to accomplish the mission of the inter-theater lift. Also, we will still be able to accomplish the role of dedicated support to the Army. The requirement there is approximately 48 to 50 aircraft and can be accomplished with the C-130 aircraft. So I'm very comfortable with what they have laid in, backed by the initial analysis that we have done.
Thank you very much. Ranking Member Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Mattis, Afghanistan, there's, you know, a couple troubling reports coming out in terms of dealing with President Karzai on the issues of, number one, on their insistence on us returning, you know, all of prisoners to them that we have captured on that issue, and then the issue of night raids, which I'd be curious about Admiral McRaven's comments on that as well. You know, it's always been a real challenge in Afghanistan, you know, having a reliable partner in the Afghan government. They certainly have their challenges. President Karzai has said many things that make it more difficult, which you're very familiar with. So I'm just curious on those two issues in particular, but then on the broader issue of how you see our partnership with Afghanistan, which obviously is so critical to the success of our effort. How is that going, and what impact do you think that should have on our strategy, depending on how those two issues and some of the other conflicts are resolved? And be curious in both General Mattis and Admiral McRaven's comments on that.
Congressman, the desire of President Karzai to have sovereignty over his country is one we fully support. The reason we're there is to stand up his military reason, and to enable, support them in standing up a government that can meet the needs of their people and ensure Afghanistan never becomes again a haven for the kind of attacks on our country that we sustained back in 9/11. There are very difficult issues that we have got to sort out between us. His desire for sovereignty mirrors our desire for Afghan sovereignty. Timelines, how you do it, the devil's in the details, so to speak. That's where we come into some of these discussions that when they get portrayed publicly show that there are differing equities involved here. But that said, with Ambassador Crocker and General Allen there representing us, knowing that we've got some very practiced and long-term allied leaders there in Minister Wardak, Minister of Defense, Minister Bismillah Khan, Minister of Interior, at the working level, we are working through these issues. They are difficult issues. These are two that cut to the very heart of their self-image. We understand that, and we're seeing an increased Afghanization of the night operations, for example. And this is exactly consistent with where we want to go and where President Karzai wants to go. They are also, I must add, the military activities that are generally least apt to have any civilian casualties, which is why we are very adamant that we must continue these to throw the enemy leadership off balance while doing the least possible harm to any of the Afghan people. But overall, after 10 years of war and the stresses that come from that, I think we're in relatively good shape.
Thank you. Admiral McRaven, you want to comment on that issue?
Yes, sir. I'll echo General Mattis's comments on night raids. It is an essential tool for our special operations forces to be able to have the ability to conduct night raids. The enemy invariably will bed down at night, which makes him that much more targetable. But as General Mattis mentioned, also what happens is the rest of the village beds down at night, so consequently the potential for collateral damage and civilian casualties is much less. What we have done is we have really Afghanized our night raid approach. Really for over probably about the last 9 to 10 months, we have made a very concerted effort. The Afghans are in the lead on all our night raids. They are the ones that do the call outs, asking the people to come out of the compounds. They are the first ones through the door. They are the ones that do all of the sensitive site exploitation. So this has really become an Afghan heavy lead on the night raids, but we continue to recommend from a soft perspective to General Mattis, General Allen, and Ambassador Crocker, that we continue the night raids.
Thank you very much. I have more questions, but I've had the opportunity to meet with all of you, so I want to give my colleagues a chance. I'll yield back. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Thornberry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank all of you for being here. Admiral McRaven, the new strategy from the administration talks about a greater emphasis on special operations forces, and in the past you have talked about a global soft network, rebalancing our soft forces around the world. There are some press reports that there are plans under consideration to give you some greater flexibility in moving special operations forces around the world. I think there may be some misunderstanding about that. Can you describe what the plan is under consideration?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Congressman, and I'm happy to set the record straight on this. Every 2 years, the Pentagon goes through the staffing process of looking at the Unified Command Plan, which lays out the missions, responsibilities of the combatant commanders. Additionally, every year we look at the Forces IV, which takes a look at the assigned forces to the combatant commanders. So U.S. SOCOM is involved in those processes. And right now that is kind of internal Pentagon deliberations. We have not even briefed this to the chairman or the secretary yet, so I think it would be a little bit inappropriate to get too far out ahead of them. Having said that, one of the things I would like to make clear is that all of our recommendations ensure that we coordinate with the geographic combatant commanders, that we get their approval before any forces are moved, soft forces are moved from the continental United States or from one geographic combatant command to the other. We also make sure that any time we go into a foreign nation, the chief of mission, the ambassador, has to approve the movement of special operations forces into that nation. So as we go through these deliberations internal to the Pentagon, those two pieces, the geographic combatant commander's equities and the chief of mission's equities, are always being considered, and we would never recommend, and I would certainly never recommend, that we circumvent either of those.
General Mattis, based on your understanding, does this seem like a good idea to you?
Yes, sir. My recommendation would be to support Admiral McRaven's initiative. I have no reservations about it, but again, it's very premature. I've not formally even submitted that recommendation, sir.
Sure. Well, let me. Speaking of press reports, let me try another one out on you. There have been press reports that there is consideration, at least somewhere in the administration, of taking all the special operations forces in Afghanistan and switching them to a Title 50 hat. And so that way we can pretend that they are not there in some way. And General Mattis, I suspect you've seen the story to which I refer. Is there any consideration of a plan like that?
None whatsoever, Congressman.
Well, take it back from a little less sensational. There are also concerns that as the numbers of conventional forces go down in Afghanistan, that our special operations troops will be asked to do more, take up those missions, or maybe even increase. And so I have some concern that as we draw down numbers, perhaps for political reasons, that we're going to stretch our special operations forces more and more, expecting more of them. What can you tell us about this ratio of soft forces to conventional forces and how that interplay is expected to go in Afghanistan?
I'd make a couple points, Congressman. First, special operations forces forte has to do with working with indigenous forces, advising, assisting them. So as we stand up using our conventional and special forces, the Afghan security forces, they are the ones who will carry more of the load. The Afghan forces will. But we do not want to simply pull the training wheels off. We don't want to pull off the people who can call in close air support for them and say you're on your own. Special forces, we'll pick up more of that, certainly, but it's in percentage, because as the number of our general purpose forces draws down towards the end of 2014, when we pull them out, we will still need the advisors there. And I think that's where the interpretation is coming, that more is going to be demanded of the special forces. I don't see it that way. I see them continuing their traditional role, and the Afghan forces, more will be demanded from them, and they're doing more each year now.
Admiral McRaven, can you just briefly comment? Y'all are going to do whatever you're asked to do, but do you not require some level of conventional forces to help as a means of support for your folks to do their job?
Sir, we absolutely do. And I think when you look at the current strategy for Afghanistan, and General Mattis and General Allen and I talk frequently about this, there is an understanding that there will have to be some conventional force capability. It remains to be seen how much capability, but there will need to be some capability as the forces remain, as our forces remain in Afghanistan. We have, I think, soft brings to the fight. Our strength is our core capabilities for counterterrorism, for COIN, counterinsurgency, and for security force assistance. Having said that, things like route clearance packages, some of the big ISR requirements, some of the CASAVAC and MEDEVAC, these are provided by the conventional forces. So we'll still need to have that capability regardless of what is left in terms of the soft force in Afghanistan.
Thank you. Mr. Reyes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Welcome, gentlemen. Thank you for your service. General Mattis, there has been a recent report that Ambassador Crocker, in a classified cable, expressed concern about the Taliban sanctuaries in Pakistan and their impact on our ability to continue to be effective in Afghanistan. My question is, would failure to eliminate the Taliban safe zones in Pakistan, is that a showstopper for us in our operations in our efforts in Afghanistan?
No, Congressman, it's not. And if I were sitting here 2.5 years ago, I would probably be asked, with the enemy, the Taliban, moving against Islamabad, only 60 miles away in Swat Valley, these havens have just become a penalty to both countries. That's recognized in both countries. And today, as you know, the Pakistan Army has thrown the Taliban back up into the mountains. They continue to fight. They fought this week. They continue to take casualties in this fight. And the havens that are there in some of those areas exist because the Pakistan Army is stretched. Now, we do have a problematic, at times, relationship with Pakistan, but that does not prevent us from working it. And there's a lot of common ground that we use, that we operate off of together against this enemy. We don't have 100% common ground about it, but it is not a showstopper.
Okay, thank you. Admiral McCraven, in the 2012 Defense Strategic Guidance, it indicates a shift to the Asia-Pacific, or an emphasis to the Asia-Pacific region. How does this impact our special ops forces, given the fact that we've been mostly focused the last 10 years in the Iraq-Afghanistan theaters?
Thank you, sir. SOF forces have had a long-standing partnership with many of our allies in the Asia-Pacific region, starting from Korea and the Philippines and Thailand, Singapore, and we expect that those relationships will continue, if not get stronger as time goes on. I would tell you what I think SOF's benefit to this new strategy is that we can then cover down with security force assistance in areas where the conventional forces may not be fully engaged, such as South America, Africa, other regions where we have applied less capability over the years. So SOF can be an enabling force in other regions as the larger conventional force shifts its emphasis on the Asia-Pacific region.
Thank you. General Fraser, the great majority of equipment that is moved by TRANSCOM goes by sea. Using ships that are operated by the Military Sealift Command, which is a component of TRANSCOM, for ships operating in maritime security programs, what do potential cutbacks mean? Would that put the companies out of business? Would that force them to mothball them? What kind of impact would be felt in that area?
Congressman, thank you. The entire command is certainly dependent upon our commercial partners. This is both for air as well as sea lift. You specifically addressed sea lift. We are doing a lot with our commercial partners with respect to sea, as we have shipped more goods, sustainment via ship, and then also before the Pakistan border was closed down, We would take it to Karachi, and then we would truck it in. The flexibility that we have with our commercial partners, though, is that when the border shut down, we were able to redirect these ships and then use their network to go to other ports, offload the sustainment supplies, offload unit cargo, store it, and then fly it in. We call this multimodal. By taking it by sea, taking it to a port, and then further onward movement, taking it in by air. As we look to the future, and we see the drawdown in Iraq already, it is having some impact because we are not doing as much by sea. We have recently gone and booked the last ships that are necessary to bring out the cargo that was brought out of Iraq, and we look forward to getting that back. But we will be doing less in the future as we move to change the size of the force also in Afghanistan. Our commercial partners are aware of that. It's going to be going down, and they need to plan accordingly.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Forbes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank all of you for your service to our country and for being with us today. I know each of us wish we could spend more time talking with you and picking your brains with the experience and knowledge that you have. General Frazier, thank you for taking time. I know how busy your schedule is, but to meet with us and talk about readiness needs, even in addition to this hearing today. General, we know that you're the commander of the U.S. Transportation Command, and just looking at the nature of that command, it's the single manager for global air, land, and sea transportation for the Department of Defense. And fancy way of basically saying you've got to get the assets to our combatant commanders when they need them. Mr. Riaz mentioned the fact that with the new strategy, we have at least a renewed focus or an additional focus in the Asia-Pacific area, and one of the big concerns there is our new air-sea battle concept and how that may play out. One of the things that we have also heard is the Navy has proposed, as you know, a reduction in their pre-positioned operating stocks, and at the same time, the F-13 budget is talking about a reduction in strategic lift. So my first question is, has Transcom done an analysis or an assessment that you could provide to the committee that would show that you could meet the needs of the combatant commanders if you have a simultaneous reduction in those pre-positioned stocks and in a reduction in the strategic lift?
Thank you, Congressman, and specifically answer the question, have we done that analysis on the maritime preposition? The answer to that is no. I know there is a requirement out there. I know that the Navy and the Marines together are taking a look at this based on the direction that that they have in the FY12 NDAA language. I look forward to that report and the certification from DOD, and then we'll take a look at it.
And General, my follow-up question, this you may not even be able to answer this, but aren't we starting to get the cart before the horse on so many of these things? Because it looks like to me that before the Navy would propose this reduction in our pre-positioned stocks, or before we would include in the budget that we're going to have a reduction in the strategic lift, that we would have done an analysis by the major command that's going to have to get those assets there. And I don't know if you can even explain, maybe it's something that's not explainable, but wouldn't it make sense to do the analysis first and say we can still get the assets to our combatant commanders before we make these recommendations and include them in the budget?
Congressman, we continue to take a holistic look on how we would provide support to whatever geographic combatant commanders' requirements might be as we look forward to the future, whether it's pre-positioned stocks, whether it's actually providing sea lift in order to get supplies there once we have indications and warning, whether it be by sea or it be by air. We have done some initial analysis in looking at the strategic lift based on very sound analytical work that was done in MCRS 16. And comfortable with the strategic lift reduction.
And General, again, please understand, I'm not putting this on you. You have to play the cards you're dealt. I'm just asking this question. Even in that holistic look we've had, there hasn't really been an analysis in that holistic look that we can still meet the requirements of our combatant commanders if we have a simultaneous reduction in our strategic lift and a reduction in those pre-positioned stocks. Is that accurate?
Sir, we're going to continue to evaluate this and take a holistic look. We have a lot of capacity within our commercial sea lift partners, too, as well as our craft partners, the Civil Reserve Air Fleet. And that capacity that we have, we continue to adapt to the needs of the combatant commanders in order to meet that. I would give an example where our craft partners stood up and gave us more capacity.
And General, I don't want to cut you off. I only have 20 seconds left. But wouldn't it be fair to my question that we haven't done the analysis, though, to make sure we can meet those combatant commanders' needs if we do both the reduction in pre-positioned stock and the strategic airlift?
I have not specifically done that scenario. I've done the scenarios of which I have been asked to look at, Congressman.
And thank you, General, for your work. And, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you. Mrs. Tsongas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good morning, gentlemen. I thank you all for being here this morning, and I commend you for your leadership over your respective commands in what we all know are very challenging times. I wanted to turn again to the issue of Afghanistan. I opposed President Obama's initial request for supplemental funding for the surge of an additional 30,000 troops because I had questions about our strategy in Afghanistan and Pakistan that I felt went unanswered. And I still believe we could do everything right in Afghanistan, a challenge in itself, but if Pakistan, a very uncertain ally, did not do its part, our efforts in Afghanistan would be seriously undermined. And while the Defense Department should be congratulated for establishing a timeline and benchmarks for success, I believe this timeline is overwhelmingly dependent on the capabilities of the Afghan National Security Forces. So, General Mattis, while I am pleased that the Afghan National Security Forces have taken the lead in seven areas, representing more than 25% of the population, I remain concerned, as I'm sure we all do, by the repeated incidents of Afghan soldiers turning their guns on coalition forces. According to a January 17 article in USA Today, since 2005, more than 50 ISAF troops have been killed and 48 wounded by Afghan troops. This attack on NATO advisors in the Afghans' own Interior Ministry 2 weeks ago was particularly alarming, since presumably anyone allowed inside would have the highest clearance levels. I would echo the comments of one senior Afghan general who said these attacks are, quote, a nightmare that refuses to go away. These horrific incidents create mistrust and frustration between NATO personnel and their Afghan counterparts. And in a visit last year to Afghanistan, I met with one of our young soldiers, and such an incident had just taken place, and he talked about the very chilling effect it had. It certainly undermines a partnership that is key to furthering our strategy to eventually transfer responsibility over to the Afghan security forces. So can you tell me what kind of vetting procedures we have in place today for Afghan security personnel? How do we, for example, address challenges such as the fact that it's common for Afghans to go only by one name, making the vetting process as challenging? And in the aftermath of this recent attack, are any of these procedures being modified?
Yes, Congresswoman, they are being modified. The vetting procedures are not precluded by the single name, for example. We get statements from village elders who know the young men and ask if they're men of good character, they don't have psychological problems, the kind of things that would be known by local leaders, not by a screening test that would be imperfect in a country where literacy is so low. We have unprecedented cooperation from the Afghan authorities on this issue. You're quite right, they see it too as a nightmare that they've got to stop. The point I would make is that the Afghan security forces, ma'am, are not defined by these occasional tragedies. We have tens of thousands of Afghan boys fighting alongside us. We have our special forces sleeping alongside them at night and our partnered conventional forces going on patrol alongside them. And while these tragedies show that that treachery and war is something that has always existed, it does not define the organization at all. More Afghan boys have died as a result of this sort of thing in a society that has been turned upside down by the Soviets some decades ago, and a Kalashnikov culture found its way inside that society. Violence has become too often the norm. It's one of the things we're trying to turn back. But in Afghanistan right now, it has not stopped us in our tracks over our strategy. Of course, we're taking prudent measures, and of course, we're adapting those measures.
I have a follow-up question. The same USA Today article reports that since the latter part of 2011, military commanders in Afghanistan no longer make public the number of allied troops killed by Afghan soldiers and police. Obviously, when there's a very visible incident, we're aware of it. Can you talk about the rationale for this change in policy? And if we run out of time, I'll take it for the record.
There is no change, ma'am. We notify the Congress, we notify the Department of Defense, we notify the families on every case where there's a casualty, whether it's an accident, what we call a green on blue, what you're asking about, enemy KIA, you know, this killed in action. We have that article is not correct. We notify all of our chain of command and the families when we take casualties.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for your service. And as I begin, General Mattis, I want to thank you for your explaining the relationship that our troops have with the Afghan security forces. My former National Guard unit, the 218th Brigade of South Carolina, led by General Bob Livingston, worked very closely helping train the Army police units, and they really developed an appreciation of their Afghan brothers. So it's an aberration, as you explain, of what's occurred. I'm really grateful. I just 2 weeks ago was on a House Democracy Partnership delegation with Congressman David Dreyer, and we visited Pakistan. And I was very pleased. We had a very warm meeting with the Prime Minister, the Chief of the Chairman of the Senate, also the Interior Minister. It was very positive, and that's such an important country for mutual agreements to be working together. So, what is the status of our resuming a relationship with the Pakistani Army and military?
Yeah, Congressman, in a couple of weeks I will be flying back out there. But the bottom line is, following the tragedy that occurred on the cross-border fires in late November, the Parliament took under consideration an investigation into what had happened and a determination of what sort of relationship they want with us in the future. Now, Congressman, as you know, this has been a challenging it is a crucial relationship, but it's been a challenging relationship, and it's been prone to recriminations on both sides. But the bottom line is that this is a critical relationship, as complicated as it is, and we have just come out in support of reconciliation in Afghanistan. That's a first, by the way. The Prime Minister made the public statement here a little over a week ago. And I think that we're on track to start recovering some of the ground lost under some of these incidents that have occurred.
Well, I appreciate it's for the mutual benefit of the people of Pakistan, Afghanistan, and America. Also, security for India having a stable Pakistan is my view. Another country that's truly impressed me is Bahrain. And I have visited there and was very happy to find out that our country's had a relationship over 100 years with the country of Bahrain, establishing hospitals. And, of course, the Fifth Fleet, Admiral, we're very proud, over 50 years. And so many Americans just do not know that we've had such a long-term association and partnership. And I would like for either one of you to explain why Bahrain is important for U.S. security interest.
First, Congressman, it is my only main operating base in the region. That is the only one that I have for Central Command in the entire Middle East region. And I think when we look at the necessity for the international community to to carry its responsibility for security in the Gulf area, that base becomes absolutely fundamental to our foreign policy, to the world's economy, and to the stability we're trying to maintain. And Bahrain has shown, we know they have had some problems over the last year. They have shown they can learn from their mistakes, and I think they have earned our support.
And I'm really grateful. I represent Hilton Head Island, and my first visit to the Persian Gulf states, including Bahrain, I felt like I was seeing Hilton Head on steroids. And it's been really frustrating to me. So many people in America feel like people in the Middle East want to evolve back to the 14th century, and that's not true. So thank you for your efforts there. And Admiral, the soft capabilities are so important to our country. What is the status of our working with our allies? Are they keeping up, particularly NATO?
Sure they are. Back in 2006, with the support of NATO, we established the NATO Soft Coordination Center, which several years later became the NATO Soft Headquarters, which it is now. The U.S. is the framework nation for the NATO Soft Headquarters. We have a three-star U.S. general that is the NATO officer in charge of that that soft element. They do an absolutely magnificent job. About 250 some odd folks on the staff there. They provide a lot of the training and the education for the somewhere in the neighborhood of the 22 NATO SOF and NATO alliance countries that are part of that SOF alliance. Just to give you an indication, in 2006 when we stood up the NATO SOF Coordination Center, there were about 300 NATO SOF members in Afghanistan. Now there are over 2,200 NATO SOF in Afghanistan. And while I can't make the direct linkage, I can tell you that by coming together as a NATO SOF element at the NATO SOF headquarters, there was a sense of commitment, there was a sense of understanding at the SOF level on what needed to be done. We have a number of courses that we train, that we teach there at the NATO SOF headquarters that teach to the NATO standard. So when these folks do deploy forward, we're very, very confident in their capability.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Garamendi.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and gentlemen, thank you for all that you do for this nation. A couple of questions. General Mattis, in your testimony, there was no information about the contingency fund for Afghanistan. Perhaps that's for a later hearing, but could you tell us what is the potential expense for 13, 14, and beyond?
Congressman, I'll have to take it for the record. It is a critical fund for what we are doing there in terms of our counterinsurgency campaign, but I need to get specifics for you. I don't want to give you general ballpark figures, sir.
Well, I certainly would appreciate that, and I suspect the number's pretty large.
They are, sir, and they're in my testimony for the Appropriations Committee, but I didn't think to put them in here. I'll correct that, sir.
Thank you. I'd appreciate that. Admiral McRaven, do you have sufficient ISR assets to carry out the tasks that you've discussed here and in your written testimony?
Sure, we do. We're very well served by our ISR assets that we get both from the SOF ISR capability and from the conventional support. So, for example, in Afghanistan, well, I don't want to talk specific numbers of orbits here. Suffice to say, we are very well resourced with ISR.
Some of those ISR assets are being retired?
Sir, none of the ISR assets that I use currently are being retired.
I think we have information that some are going to be retired. Some of the platforms that are operating out of Beale Air Force Base, for example.
Sir, I use primarily the MQ-9s, the MQ-1s, and then we have a large fleet of manned aircraft, small manned aircraft. Those, to the best of my knowledge, the orbits are not going away. I will continue to get the orbits that I need. Whether or not the individual platforms are being modified, such as the MQ-1, that I'll have to get back to you on, sir.
Please do, and I'd like some specific information on how those assets are used in the Horn of Africa.
Sure.
And Congo. Okay. Back to you, General Mattis. A recent New York Times article indicated that there may be some discrepancy in the reporting of the success or failures in Afghanistan. Are you familiar with that article?
Not in particular, sir. I've read articles alleging that sort of thing, but I'm not, I don't recall if it's that. Sir, we are very confident that we are given a rigorous analysis when we make our assessments of how we are doing there. And just the fact that we've been so reluctant over many years to say that we were on the right track, and now we can show right down to the district level how it's going, shows the detailed rigor that we put into this. And we don't assess it simply from an episodic role. We talk to the sergeants and captains on the ground. We talk to the Afghans on the ground. We're very confident that we've got as good as an objective and subjective melded together assessment can give us.
So therefore, we should have confidence in the information that we receive from the Department of Defense.
Absolutely, sir.
Okay. I'll end my questions at that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Turner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you for your service and your commitment. General Mattis, over the past several years, I have tried to focus my attention on the Afghan narcotics trade as a major source of funding for the insurgents. In 2006, General James Jones, then the Supreme Allied Commander of Europe, stated, quote, "The Achilles heel of Afghanistan is the narcotics problem." He went on to state, "I think the uncontrolled rise of the spread of narcotics, the business that it brings in, the money that it generates is being used to fund the insurgency, the criminal elements, anything to bring chaos and disorder." In 2010, the United Nations Office of Drugs and Crime published a study showing that the opium production rapidly increased in Afghanistan from the period of 2006 to 2010. General, I've showed you this chart before. This is a chart from CRS that basically expresses that period. It shows the peak. I'm fond of folding this chart in half because it shows that what we're dealing with is a spike that exceeds the what is the historical level of production of previous periods. So we saw from that period a nearly doubling of production. In a recent correspondence with General Allen, he told me that, quote, "The narcotics trade and its linkage to the insurgency contribute to regional insecurity, corruption, volatility in the rule of law, the stagnation of economic development." General Petraeus agreed that it was a serious problem, noting that the trade financed roughly one-third of the Taliban's funding. In an attempt to confront this issue, I've discussed this issue with you, General Mattis, President Karzai, General Petraeus, General Allen, and the DAA, just to name a few. And in response to my question on this issue last year, you stated, quote, "The U.S. government and other international partners, including the Afghans, are reducing poppy cultivation and opium production in Afghanistan. Our intra-agency counter-narcotic strategy supports a comprehensive set of actions to reduce opium production," close quote. "This strategy includes a public information campaign, good performance initiative, a complementary efforts in law enforcement and justice capacity within the counter-narcotics police, Afghanistan, and specialized units such as DAA, sponsored national interdiction and special investigative units, and collaborative work with USAID. I compliment you on your leadership on these efforts as they appear to have had success. The United Nations Office of Drugs and Crime, April 2011 winter poppy assessments demonstrated a decrease in 2011 poppy production. Further, in correspondence with General Petraeus last year, he told me that his forces, quote, have seen a 48% increase in, a 48% decrease in opium production in the first quarter of 2011, and that they saw a 341% increase in drug seizures compared to the same period a year ago. So I can hold up this new chart, which I'll also fold in half, which shows the spike downward. And if you fold it in half and look at that period that we were concerned with, you can see that we have once again returned to a lower level that is more historic. In the chart that General Petraeus has shown of the spike of the seizures of the drugs have had a huge impact. Okay, now while I find these trends reassuring, I am concerned that the premature drawdown of U.S. and ISAF forces in Afghanistan may reverse this trend and allow the insurgents to regain this lucrative source of funding. General Mattis, are we still pushing these programs to the degree that you indicated in your response that we received in August? Are we still seeing the same positive results? Do you anticipate that these positive results will continue as we draw down our forces? Does the Afghan Army have the capacity to address these counter-narcotic efforts? And if this administration ignores the advice of its combat commanders, what do you anticipate happening to the counter-narcotics effort in Afghanistan in the future? Can we continue to see this lower level of poppy production? General.
Congressman, this is an intimate part of going after this insurgency, and I would agree with the one-third of their funds were coming, we're sure, from the poppy trade. So we've got to get our handle on it. Also, this criminal patronage network that is funded by the various drug producing, whether it be the facilities where they refine it, the network that gets it out of the country and the return, the money coming back in, that then poisons all the local people who see the lucrative nature of this until they're drawn away from legitimate crops and this sort of thing. This is all having a rot effect on Afghanistan. The result is that we stay unrelenting in our pursuit of this criminal patronage network, whether it's specific to the Taliban or it's simply a feeder into the Taliban, it's still part of our targeted enemy. We have also got a much stronger international effort going on right now, and that grows each year. This is a regional problem as well as an Afghanistan problem. So the answer is that we will create an Afghan National Army, Afghan National Police that has this capacity if we continue on the track we're on right now. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. Mr. Johnson.
Thank you. Admiral McCraven, as you know, there's much speculation about timing and nature of drawdown in Afghanistan, including the possibility that we will shift to a model where substantial special operations forces remaining in the country would be subordinated to the CIA and operate under Title 50 authority, as they did for the bin Laden raid. And this has been reported in the Associated Press on March 3rd as coming from high-level Pentagon officials, which I assume to be one or all of you all. Is my assumption correct, and are these reports true?
No, sir, the reports are false. We have no plans right now to put special operations forces under Title 50 in Afghanistan.
So no plans at the present, but assuming that that did become operational at some point in the future, it would raise complex oversight questions. And if such a plan was put into effect, at what level of specificity would the Department of Defense be required to report such use of special operations forces under CIA command to this committee?
Sir, all I can tell you is right now we have no plans to do that. Now, the special operations forces work routinely with the intelligence community, and we do occasionally partner with the CIA, and occasionally we will put SOF operators with the CIA in very small numbers as required. That oversight goes through the normal CIA oversight channels. So whatever SOF personnel are assigned to the CIA, then the committees will have full visibility over those personnel and those missions. But right now, again, there are no plans, absolutely no plans right now, to put special operations forces under Title 50 in Afghanistan either now or for the future that I'm aware of?
Well, there's nothing that would ban such a plan from being implemented at this time. But let me ask the question this way, Admiral. Is the military required to report, is the military required to report to this committee specific operations conducted by Special Operations Forces under CIA command?
Sir, I can certainly talk about specific incidences, but I would prefer to do that in a more closed session, if we could.
Well, I'm not looking at specific instances. I'm just looking at generally policy-wise. Is there any requirement that you know of that would require you to report specific operations to this committee, to the House Armed Services Committee, as opposed to the Intelligence Committee?
Yes, sir. Sir, what I can tell you is
actually, the Defense Department would not be required to report to the Intelligence Committee, but would it be required to report to the House Armed Services Committee?
Sir, if it is an intelligence operation, then it is reported to the intelligence committees. So if it is under CIA as an intelligence operation, then it is reported to the intelligence committees. If it is under Title 10 and it is a special operation mission, then it is reported to the Armed Services Committees.
This, and of course, the House Armed Services Committee does have budgetary authority over the Special Operations Command, but apparently there is no restriction on special ops being able to pass off, if you will, the operational authority for Special Operations Forces to the intelligence community, which is more than just the CIA. No restrictions on that, and thus, if that happens, then there's no report that is required
gentleman's
that
time
activity
is,
back to the
gentleman's time has expired.
House Armed Services Committee, and thank you. If
we do get, Mr. Smith and I get briefings at a higher level than what they do.
But no way that
we can,
or no requirement that the committee as a whole, in a secret session, if that's what it requires,
we can, Mr. Johnson, we can talk to you about that after.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Whitman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Mattis, Admiral McCraven, General Frazier, thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you for your leadership in leading the best military the world's ever known. We deeply appreciate that. Admiral McCraven, I want to begin with you in looking at where we are in Afghanistan with the pending drawdown of conventional forces and looking at the redirection or refocusing in strategy where SOCOM's manning, their budget, their operations roles are going to increase. It appears highly likely that SOCOM's presence, Special Operating Forces presence in Afghanistan is going to continue past 2014. With that being said, we know that enablers have to be there to support our Special Operations Forces. We know today, with the conventional forces is there, there's a pretty robust number of enablers there and a depth of enablers there. My question is this: going forward, as conventional forces are drawn down, who will be the enablers for our special operators there in the theater? Are there going to be enough special operators? Are they going to have the depth necessary to make sure our special operators have all that they need in those particular circumstances? And I'm going to lead that into another question and then turn it over to you. General Mattis had stated previously that the insurgency remains both resilient and capable, so we must remain vigilant and resolved as our gains are reversible. The fear is that as conventional forces draw down and our special operators have more tasks there in theater, that they get spread too thin and that they don't have that support group, those enablers there. The question is are we getting to a point where we're asking our special operators to do so much in a time where we know the Taliban's going to be pretty active in seeking out where weakness is, not just with the Afghan forces, but seek out where weaknesses may be in our forces as the support forces for the Afghans. Can you tell me, are we putting ourselves in peril with the situation we're putting our special operators in, especially based on General Mattis's comments?
Sure. Thank you, Congressman. First, I'll address the enablers issue. Special Operations Forces deploy with a certain set of enablers, primarily our ISR requirements, a lot of our helicopter lift, some of our internal CASAVAC capabilities. So we're fairly robust when we deploy. Having said that, as you pointed out, we do rely quite a bit on the services there for things like route clearance packages if we're moving from point A to point B. The services do provide some additional helicopter assault forces and some additional ISR. So as the forces begin to draw down, we will be in constant dialogue with General Allen, General Mattis, and our ISAF partners to ensure that the right level of enablers are there. And we have been having these discussions for quite some time, recognizing that the President has already made the decision to move down to 68K on the U.S. side. So I'm pretty comfortable that we're having good discussions on this and that that all the right folks understand what our requirements will be as we stay in Afghanistan to 2014. On the issue of the fact that the insurgency will remain resilient and capable, it is worth recognizing that as we ramp up to about 352K in terms of the Afghan National Security Forces, that force will take on the bulk of the fight against the insurgency. On the soft side, as you know, we are training the Afghan commandos, the Afghan special forces, we have Afghan partner units, and then, of course, our local police, the NATO soft folks are training a lot of folks as well. So as we look at the drawdown occurring, the expectation, and I think a very real expectation, is that our Afghan partners will step it up as we provide them increased capability, and they'll be able to take the lead and do the job themselves.
Very good. That's going to lead me into the next question. You talk about the challenges there and the role our special operators play. I know that there are two critical missions there, the village stability operations and also training the Afghan local police. With special operators, though, making up about 8% of the force there, as this transition occurs and we're putting more and more emphasis on the Afghans to be able to take up some of these responsibilities, hoping that they're able to assume them, our conventional forces leaving, seems like to me there's more focus and there's much more pressure on our special operators that if things don't go as planned with the Afghans, both local police and the NSF, where does that leave your special operators? In other words, if they're placed in a situation where things start to decay a little bit, is the capability there with them only being 8% of the total force structure that's there now, and then they're going to carry a much greater share of the load under what probably is going to end up being some pretty challenging scenarios? Can you tell me where you feel they will be? Are they going to be properly supported? Are we going to make sure that we're not asking too much of them in that situation?
Gentleman's time has expired. If you could submit that to the record, please. Mrs. Davis.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to all of you and your very challenging positions that you hold. I want to just follow up very quickly on the sustainment issue, because I know that, you know, the American public certainly understands that the Afghanistan government is not able to support their military monetarily now and probably not into the distant future. Where do you see those resources coming from? The international community as a whole has been providing those with us in the lead. Do you see that being sustained? And if not, how are we going to sustain the rest of the military? And I think just to the NATO enablers and the issues around logistics from on a score of 1 to 5, I guess, where do you see the logistics capability now and their ability to maintain their own logistics, but going down the line, even some of the infrastructure that's been put in?
Congresswoman, as the President has stated, we're not going to abandon Afghanistan in 2014. So it begs the question, how are we going to sustain this in the long term so Afghanistan does not again become a haven for the kind of attacks we took on 9/11? I think the international community will have to sustain a fairly robust aid network going into Afghanistan. But at the same time, Afghanistan is starting to get some economic vitality showing up from extraction industries and other and education system just trying to turn out people who are actually employable to do things that are more than just subsistence farming. Certainly agriculture has a great potential to create more wealth. At one time, as you know, Afghanistan exported food outside its borders. I think, too, that logistically, we have put in place logistics schools for the military so they can maintain the military infrastructure and equipment we're giving them. All of this is in its nascent stages, of course, because we had to start from such a low starting point in a country where literacy and any kind of governmental organization was totally lacking. So it's going to be it's going to be difficult. I think the international community will have to continue, but it will taper off too, as inside Afghanistan, some degree of an economic basis actually gets gets started, gets rolling there.
Thank you. If I could, I'm going to just switch to Syria because I want to give you time to respond to that as well. Could you comment on the security of the Syrian chemical weapons? What do we know about that? What can you share with us?
In open session, ma'am, we think the chemical weapons are secured right now. We've seen no indications of use against their own people at this point, but it's something we're keeping a very, very close eye on.
Could you comment as well on the security situation in Syria and how it affects Iran, how that landscape might change if, in fact, Assad stepped down or was removed from office?
Well, when Assad goes, ma'am, and he will go, I don't know if it'll be next month or it'll be a longer period of time. When he goes, it will be the most significant strategic setback for Iran in 20 years.
And that's that's as much as you'd like to share at this time.
The thing is, ma'am, I think the situation, the tragedy that's unfolding there, and Assad's willingness to use force and a lot of force against his people, would certainly it convinces me the situation is probably going to get worse there before it gets better, and it's going to take some kind of an international regional solution.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. And finally, just if you could comment on leveraging the expertise and the capabilities of others, of all of our men and women who were serving. Obviously, there have been tremendous changes in the role of women as they've been engaged in Iraq and Afghanistan. And there is a report that suggests that women can serve in many more positions. I know that the services are looking at some physical standards that would affect them. How what would you like us to know about that role and how you see it changing? We're continuing to train women in their role in Afghanistan, and yet we're also looking to exit. But how do you see that continuing to engage women in a very different role than they played in the past?
Ma'am, as the combatant commander, I can just say that the armed services, Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, have given to me men and women who are superbly trained. I think we've got it about right in terms of the employment of the women. I don't have any demand signal to go one way or another. I think the services are giving me what I need at this time.
Thank you.
Gentlelady's time has expired. Dr. Heck.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, gentlemen, for your service as well as for the service of those that you command. General Mattis, you had stated a little bit earlier that you expect that it's going to be the Afghan National Security Forces that will kind of fill the operational void as we draw down. But yet recent data reveals that of the Afghan National Army units assessed, only 36% are effective independently or with purely advisory support, that only 44% of the Afghan National Police Battalions assessed were similarly effective. So how confident are you that the Afghan National Security Forces will be capable to assume that responsibility?
Congressman, I'm relatively confident. It's hard standing up an army in the middle of a fight against an enemy that even goes after women and children. Creating an ethical force under those conditions is a challenge. But what we have found, for example, we wanted to be at 352,000 by October to have them at full strength finally. We're going to be there within 60 days. Afghan boys are willing to fight. We want them to fight right. We want them to fight well. And certainly there's challenges standing up these units and putting them right into combat. We learned that in World War II in Korea in our own Army. But at the same time, I'm relatively confident this is on the right track.
Thank you. And Admiral McRaven, the FY13 budget request decreases funding for the undersea mobility program 62% from $68 million to $26 million. Given the current and aging fleet of SEAL delivery vehicles and the fact that we have significant capability gaps in that area, what are some of your concerns with this funding decrease, and how is it going to impact our ability to contribute to the anti-access and area denial mission areas?
Sir, thank you. I've taken a hard look at our undersea mobility program, and actually as we went through the budget drills for fiscal year 13, I felt we could assume a little bit of risk in our light submersible program, recognizing that we have recommended a medium submersible program that we think will cover down on that gap, as you talked about, for the area denial piece. So I think with the current SEAL delivery vehicles we have, and we have some modifications that we're making to those, along with the recommended budget that will include the medium submersible program, that gives us the capability we need within Naval Special Warfare.
Thank you. I yield back, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Mr. Courtney.
Thank you, Mr. Thornberry, and thank the gentleman for your testimony. General Mattis, there's starting to be some growing voices about airstrikes, U.S.-led airstrikes in Syria, and you, in your testimony, talked about how challenging that country's situation is for our military. Looking last year in terms of Odyssey Dawn, I mean, again, our military did a magnificent job of sort of coordinating with NATO, an operation that at least superficially would seem to be similar. I just wonder if you could maybe talk a little bit more about what you see as the challenges, because certainly it's on the talk shows and every Sunday lately.
Yeah, Congressman, each operation is unique, of course, and we have to be careful about templating an operational approach to a unique situation. Our challenge in Syria is that with Assad's willingness to murder his own people, we're in a situation where we have to do something to stop this. I provide options to the president. I can just tell you that options such as working with the Syrian opposition, we'd have to perhaps get a little more fidelity so we know who exactly we're working with, and then look at the end state we're trying to achieve and come up with regional partners, the best, and international partners, the best possible way to go forward. I think right now the efforts to bring increasing diplomatic and economic pressure on the Assad regime are exactly the right way to go.
Well, thank you. I'm glad you at least stated clearly that the situation is intolerable, and we can't just sort of watch. I mean, we've got to do more than that. But hopefully these other tools are going to affect some change there. In your testimony regarding Pakistan, again, you sort of articulated support for some of the assistance that we're still providing there. I have to share with you, I've been at VFWs lately where staunch pro-military veterans come up to me and rather angry about the events that we saw unfold in Abbottabad and what I think most people think was clearly a situation that the government there was aware of. Admiral Mullen's testimony regarding the Haqqani network's connections to Pakistani intelligence. And the question is posed to me at these meetings is like, why are we providing any support for this government? I thought maybe, got a couple minutes left on my time here, you could articulate for people who, again, are not hostile to your mission, but really question, what's the value here?
Congressman, the questions are valid. The point I would make is in this, it's a very challenging but a crucial relationship that we maintain with Pakistan. I have looked at the evidence. I do not believe anyone in authority was aware that Osama bin Laden was in Abbottabad. And I'm not reluctant to say what I think. I'm rather well known for saying what I think. I don't think that they knew about it. We are going to have to sustain a workable relationship. And for example, along the border, there is collaboration going on. Now, it's not complete. It's not at the level we want. There's disagreements on some aspects of who's the enemy and who is not. And over years, some of this has shifted below both of our feet. But the threat that the enemy projects is a threat to Pakistan as much as it is to Afghanistan. The Pakistan military has taken a lot of casualties. They've probably lost more people in this war than NATO combined has lost. So my point would be that we continue to search for the common ground. We fight in many cases in a collaborative way. I could not have gone in 2001 to southern Afghanistan absent Pakistan's support. I would not have, I needed their support. So it has not been perfect by a long sight. And certainly we have got to overcome some of the recriminations from both sides that have characterized the relationship. But I think in the long term, the shared requirements we both have to address this situation will find us more common ground that we can work from.
Mr. West.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen, for being here. I want to try to get a question into each and every one of you. First of all, General Mattis, when you look at your CENTCOM AOR, what is your assessment of the resulting unintended consequences of going to no credible, no viable, no military presence, U.S. military presence in Iraq?
Congressman, in Iraq, we now have a State Department-led effort. I have a lieutenant general there with an Office of Security Cooperation with several hundreds U.S. military, but even a larger number of contractors who help on bringing in the equipment that they have purchased, training them on that equipment. We are also working around the region for the regional militaries to invite the leadership from the Iraqi military to countries and exercises around the region so we get them out of their pariah status. Okay. We have pretty good relations. We have very good relations because of the years we spent fighting together, and we are going to try to sustain those so we don't take those kind of costs that could come from the lighter footprint.
Thank you very much. Admiral McCraven, one of the privileges I had was to command a battalion in Iraq in 2003. As a matter of fact, my XO is sitting right there now, Colonel Rich Root. You know, one of the key tasks that we had was provide outer cordon for special operations direct missions that were going on. And that's one of my concerns, and I think you've heard that here, talking about that relationship between conventional forces and special operations forces. So is that going to be a consideration as we draw down? I understand we're working very well at the VSO programs, working well with the Afghan Special Operations Commando units, but I think there still is a comfort of the special forces elements having an American conventional force that can provide some type of security or outer cordon. So will we make sure we consider that as we go through the drawdown leading up to 2014?
Sir, we'll absolutely consider it. And again, General Allen, General Mattis, and I have these discussions quite frequently about what is the right balance between the soft element out there and the conventional forces. You'd probably be happy to know we actually have two conventional battalions that are assigned to the soft elements out there helping with the VSO program, and they have been very successful at that. So as we move forward, recognizing what that balance is as the numbers draw down will be crucial. But I'm happy to say the dialogue is very strong, and I'm very comfortable that as we move forward in that direction, we're going to get that right balance.
Good. And General Fraser, as we look at this 21st century battlefield, and the enemy is going to always be in tough spots, so it's very difficult for us to get to. Are we looking at logistical and transportation networks that enable us to be a little bit more expeditionary so that we don't have to come and depend upon questionable countries such as Pakistan? Because I think that, you know, we talked about last time when you were here, General, the littorals and how we can, you know, deploy and get into these areas without having a big logistical footprint. So is there some move that we can look to seeing that at TRANSCOM?
Absolutely, Congressman. We take a look at that from an en route infrastructure perspective and where we have access. And I am very pleased with a recent report that we have completed called the En route Infrastructure Master Plan that we put in. It's a global look where we're going to have access, where we need to make investments, and where we need to partner. And I think as we go forward and continue to exercise and work with the ground component commanders in their exercise program, this will build trust, it will build confidence, also build partnership capacity, and potentially maybe the opportunities to get engaged in other airfields, other seaports, things of this nature. But I'm confident that we've got a solid plan. It's a balanced plan, too.
Very well. And, gentlemen, please give all your soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines my best. Thank you very much. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Kissel.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Welcome all of you today, and especially Admiral McCraven. I'd like to recognize your previous headquarters at being at the Fort Bragg, the justified center of the universe, as we refer to it. General Frazier, some while back we got word from our Air National Guards that somebody wanted their C-130s, and that was diverted. And just wondering, with the airlift change in capacities, does our Air National Guard folks need to worry about their C-130s again?
Congressman, I don't have any the specifics that you're referencing there. I know that the Air Force is taking a look and has a proposed bed down plan with respect to all of their assets, and I can't pass up this opportunity to thank and appreciate all the contributions that all the Guardsmen and the reservists provide to us. We're a total force, and we in Transcom are the recipients of that on a day-to-day basis, and very much value their contributions.
If something happens where they should be worried, give us a heads up on that one, please. Yep. General Mattis, we had recently some situations in Afghanistan resulting from how certain materials at a prison was handled. And I had some conversations with somebody who talked about that one of the good things coming out of that is the Afghan Army took the lead in kind of settling that situation, and that there's a commission including some of the people from the religious part of Afghanistan to investigate and see what happened, and also towards the long-term effect, if any. Kind of where does this situation stand now?
Congressman, it was a very unfortunate, inadvertent mishandling of the religious materials, but the performance of the Afghan security forces, disciplined, restrained, was pretty magnificent. Under these kind of stresses, when you're actually having to stand against your own people, it's a tough situation. They were, in a word, magnificent in carrying out their duties and standing with us and restoring calm. Right now, there are three investigations underway. One is by the U.S., since there are certain orders that we give and SOPs that we insist on. We have to look at our own culpability and were any of our procedures, our commander's orders violated. One is by a joint Afghan NATO senior officer, general officer commission, and one was by the religious folks there. In all three of these, two of them have reported out, the joint one and the religious one, and the U.S. investigation is still underway at this time.
Yeah. And Admiral McCraven, also someone, you guys were talking about the night raids. It was pointed out to me recently that President Karzai has problems with this. The rank and file population of Afghanistan welcomes them because it gets rid of bad guys. And you were talking about how we're training special forces for the Afghan so they can take the lead. But also have heard that we have recently asked for Afghan ladies to become trained as special forces so they can be involved in this. And just wondering if you can expand a little bit on what the general view from the Afghan population is toward night raids and towards this specialty of asking ladies to become involved.
Sir, thank you. On the night raids, when I was there, over the past 3 years as one of the commanders of one of the soft units there, we routinely brought in governors, Afghan governors. We brought in some of the senators. We brought in some of the parliamentarians to talk to them about how special operations conducted their missions within Afghanistan. And I will tell you, across the board, after we had those discussions with the Afghan senior leaders, and they had an appreciation for how we did things, how small the civilian casualty rate was, they came away with a much greater appreciation. And I will tell you, at that point in time, I felt very comfortable that they understood the value of night raids. And sometimes, for political reasons, they will tend to use the night raids kind of against us in order to gain some political leverage within their province, their district, et cetera. But having said that, my sense in talking to most of the leadership and up and down the chain of command, the Afghan chain of command, is that they are reasonably supportive of night raids, particularly when it takes out a high-value individual that's creating problems in their region with minimum civilian casualties, which is what we try to do every time. In terms of the females, sir, we have U.S. female cultural support teams much along the line of the Army and the Marine Corps' female engagement teams. They have been very, very successful. We are working with the Afghans now to see if we can get Afghan females to take on that role of being able to talk Afghan female to Afghan female. And we hope that that program will take root and be as successful as some of our other female engagement programs.
Once again, thank you, gentlemen. I yield back.
Mr. Conaway.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you for being here today. General Mattis, kind of playing back off what the chairman started off in terms of his conversation with you, there, you've got some reprogramming requests into the committee relative to Iran area of operation. Can you visit with us about what you're trying to strengthen and or what are the changes there that's driving these reprogramming requests?
As you'll understand, Congressman, I keep a very weather eye on this situation with reference to Iran. As we look at anything that's revealed in terms of their capabilities, we're looking to see if there's something new coming out. And in a couple of cases, they've brought up capabilities either faster than we anticipated, and these are relatively minor refocusing our effort. In other words, there's no significant area where I've got to come in and say we've got a big problem here. They're just areas I want to make certain we maintain our edge. And each of those cases are justified in detail, and I can discuss those with you. I'd prefer to discuss those in your office with you, sir.
All right. When's the last time we did a missile defense test in that area with our Gulf partners? Have we done one?
Routinely and within the last 30 days, sir.
All right. I was in Abu Dhabi recently, and the Patriot Battery commander there that was training the Abu Dhabis was jealous of their, Block 3 or whatever you call system. He said that's better than what he has in his normal duty station. Admiral McCaven, Alan West may have touched on this a little bit. Last October, I was in Kunduz at a village stability operation area. They're working on local Afghan national police. Local police, driven or led by a soft or an Army A-team, and the limitations, and they were augmented by non-soft forces. Limitations seemed to be that the A-team had to lead each of these areas. Have you looked at expanding in other words, can we get to all of the villages that need to have this done by the time the clock runs out? And are you looking at ways of moving some of that mission maybe out of the direct A-team folks to broader military to make sure we get it all done in time?
Sir, when we started the village stability program almost 2 years ago now, and then the Afghan local police program, which is one of the security components of the village stability program, we mapped out each individual site that we were looking to grow to. General Petraeus came in and actually asked us to expand that, which we did. So they have done some very, very detailed analysis looking at where every ALP/VSO site ought to be. And we are moving along a very good azimuth to get to all those sites in time. What we do, it takes really about 18 to 24 months from the time that a Special Forces ODA comes into an area, gets together with the tribal leadership, gets the shura, gets the approval of the villagers, gets the linkage to the MOI, gets the Afghan local police funded, and we are in a position where we are confident that then we can provide oversight. So part of the plan is establishing the Afghan local police units, and then when they are fully capable of standing on their own 2 feet, the Special Forces folks kind of move on to the next site, but provide oversight and overwatch to that particular ALP site. So as we grow from our current 11,000 up to approximately 30,000 folks, ALPs, that will be part of the scheme of maneuver. So we will always have a Special Forces Officer NCO or a Special Operations Operator, a Navy SEAL or a Marine Special Operations Officer NCO, providing either direct support or overwatch with our Afghan commandos and Afghan Special Forces folks as well.
Is the, maybe you speak a little bit to the post period when we're mostly gone. Are there plans in place to train the Afghans to do that overwatch and also expand that policy as well as, I guess, police the police on a going forward basis once we're no longer there looking over their shoulder?
Sir, the Afghan commandos and the Afghan Special Forces have been integral to everything we're doing on the ALP program. So the expectation is if we were to depart in 2014, then the Afghan commandos and the Special Forces will be able to take up that that role and provide the oversight necessary for the ALP program.
And you're confident that we got enough capacity and time between now and 2014 to get to that 30,000?
Sir, to get to that 30,000, yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And gentlemen, thank you all for your service. Appreciate it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Ms. Bordaglio.
Thank you, Chairman Thornberry, and good afternoon, gentlemen. I want to thank you for your important and dedicated service to our country. General Frazier, I have a couple of quick questions for you, and it's good to see you again today. As you are well aware of the President's initiative to increase our force presence in the Asia-Pacific region, can you share with the committee the strategic significance of Guam in your global in-route infrastructure, and how critical will it be for the future stability and the growth of this region?
Congressman, well, thank you very much, and good to see you again, too. The global look that we have taken is certainly something that is going to be important to us as we look forward to the future, because we don't know where the next call will come, whether it's a humanitarian response or it is responding to a crisis of some other nature. As we take a look at the Pacific and what we have out there, there's a number of things that I feel confident that we'll be able to capitalize on. And one is our commercial partners and the access that they have, be it through seaports or airfields and things of this nature, which will enable us to support the large region in the Pacific. Also, as we've discussed the other day, when I take a look at the importance of Hawaii, but also of Guam, it is going to be a vital link as we look forward in the Pacific in the ability to get access and to forward deploy our forces there. So Guam is vital to us as a link in the Pacific.
Thank you. Thank you, General. How does the budget support U.S. TRANSCOM for their strategic imperatives, such as increased focus on the Asia-Pacific region and investments in new technologies or infrastructure?
We are very well supported as we work through our Transportation Working Capital Fund, but also if I would refer back to our en route infrastructure plan that we have. We have a process by which we are able to evaluate the en route infrastructure and then balance that against both CONUS and OCONUS requirements. We feed that into a process not only through a global look, but also with our combatant commanders and with the services to garner that support, and we are very well serviced.
Thank you very much, General. And I know I have time left, but I'm going to yield back. I did visit with the General yesterday. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Gibson.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Let me just say that I think organizing this hearing with the Central Command, the Special Operations Command, and Transportation Command has been productive. I think the written testimony, unfortunately I missed the opening remarks, but I read the written testimony and the dialogue here. I think today's been very informative. Gentlemen, thank you for being here, for your service, for your leadership. Admiral McCraven, let me just start by saying I strongly support what you're doing. I think the initiatives that you're taking are making our country safer. Talking particularly now about TSOC and other matters that you have ongoing, and also want to commend the coordination that you're doing with the regional combatant commanders to bring this about, and tell you that the field trips that I've taken recently have really highlighted a burgeoning capability that I really I'm optimistic about going forward. I did note that the interagency capacity and teamwork there is it appeared to me largely through personalities and through informal arrangements. All the more commendable where we are today, but concerning just from a systemic standpoint, looking, I would hope, at some point towards codification or solidification in some way of the, some of the things that you're doing that I saw on field trips. And so, as you know, Admiral, we asked for a study, our committee asked for a study. I'm just curious to know, don't want to get out in front of this. I know it may be part of other studies that you're doing, but curious to know the timeline for completion of that study to share with the committee, and if you had any remarks you wanted to make on this. And Mr. Chairman, of course, I know you're tracking. This is a study with asking the Admiral for his thoughts on organization within the command. Thanks.
Thank you, Congressman. First, I'll address the interagency issue. As you point out, we have tremendous relationships with the interagency across the board. And I think this really began to develop as a result of 9/11. And while we've always had special operations, has always had an enduring relationship with the intelligence community and with law enforcement community, 9/11 really kind of solidified that. And today we're probably at the peak of that. I look around just for U.S. SOCOM alone. I've got somewhere in the neighborhood of 300 interagency folks that are assigned to U.S. Special Operations Command from all of the agencies, and that partnership is crucial to us. So regarding the study, as you point out, we're in the process of completing that, and we will forward that when the time comes. I'm very satisfied with U.S. SOCOM and the current organizational structure writ large. However, as every new commander comes in, there are small tweaks I'm making inside the headquarters. And as you point out, my long-term intent is to be able to provide, as a force provider, the finest forces I can to the geographic combatant commanders and to the chiefs of mission as required. And with the support we've gotten in this year's budget, I think we're well poised to do that.
Very well. Thank you for that, and look forward to receiving the study. General Frazier, as you pointed out earlier in some of your responses, that the mobility study that we have is based on 2009. It certainly predates the current change in direction in our strategy. And having experienced firsthand the under-resourcing of strategic lift for a mission, and I'm referring here for the earthquake response for Haiti in January of 2010. Certainly a lot going on then, surging in Afghanistan, I get all that. But we're all products of our experience. And so I come with some trepidation when I see how we're preparing to move forward with regard to strategic lift. And so I come at this with a question that says, Have we modeled this, and what are the plans in terms of simulations and exercises to validate the assumptions that were made for reduction in strategic lift? And in the planning that you've done, what assumptions were made in terms of lead time? I mean, we've had over the last decade, and even going back to when I was a young lad, I mean, 1990, we had lead time, and we were able to move equipment and people, and there's no guarantee that we would have that if we really needed it. And of course we have provisions to use civilian aircraft, but that would depend on the situation, on how permissive it would be to use that. So I'm certainly interested to hear your response to these.
Thank you, Congressman. The analytical rigor that went into the mobility capabilities study is still valid, and it is something that we have taken and then done some analysis from in order to support the further reduction of strategic airlift. And that's how we come to the conclusion that we do, that we can support the Air Force in their position with the oversized, outsized cargo lift capabilities of the C-17 and also the C-5. With respect to Haiti, of course, there were a lot of different things that created the challenges that we had with Haiti. You had a single runway there. You didn't have a taxiway, so you would max out the ability on the ground right away. You had a lot of international support. There was a lot of coordination necessary. We couldn't get the port open right away. So there were a lot of other variables associated with it. So it was not just the strategic lift piece, because we did have capacity. And we also had the ability to fly shorter-legged aircraft, such as C-130s or other things, to get capability in there to support that operation. The analytical rigor needs to be done again to take a look at what the requirements are as a result of a change in the strategy.
And are there plans for that in the coming year to model, simulate, exercise in some way so that we get a finer level of confidence?
Sir, we're always evaluating, and we have an organization that does that.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you, gentlemen. Yield back.
Admiral McCraven, the study to which Mr. Gibson referred was due March 1st. Do you have any idea when we might get that?
Sir, we'll get it to you absolutely as soon as possible, sir.
Thank you. Mr. Runyon.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And gentlemen, thank you for your testimony and your service to our country. All my questions are actually for General Fraser. Dealing a lot with the with CRAF and our service there with, obviously, we had testimony in front of this committee from the Air Force. Other members of the Air Force have stated that we're literally flying the blades, quote, flying the blades off the 47, referring to Chinooks. And even our strategic airlift fleet has dramatically exceeded its planned program record. Since 02, C-17s exceeded their program by over 103,000 hours, and C-5s have exceeded theirs by 151,000, according to this committee's research. Can you explain to the committee how Air Mobility Command and overfly these levels nominally for training purpose when craft carriers could have been cheaper, reduce the tremendous recapitalization costs that we will soon face, and have enabled American carriers to reinvest in more fuel efficient aircraft to support the department?
Congressman, thank you very much. And first I would comment that I've not seen those hours that you specifically referenced there. I know that as a result of the surge and as a result of other no-notice requirements with respect to our strategic airlift, they did overfly the planned flying hour program. I thought it was by about 6% and maybe by about 30% total overflying that, but that was due to other requirements. Other requirements such as the surge, such as the other things that they were asked to do. Oversized, outsized cargo is not available in the craft. It's not a requirement, and so therefore it is not available, and it was necessary from an organic perspective in order to satisfy their requirements to overfly those programs. So it's not available in the craft. We depend on the craft for cargo as well as packs. And we continue to do that and are very much appreciative of what they do. Example is how fast they're able to turn to give us extra capacity. When we were asked to bring the troops home from Iraq before the holiday period, they provided additional capacity to us, and we were able to accomplish that mission ahead of schedule. So I very much appreciate what our craft partners do for us. As we do look to the future, there are concerns. As they see a downturn in the government business, if you please, they're having to take a look at their business models as they move to the future and shift more of the business to the commercial side, vice relying on the military to provide that income that they have been dependent upon here in the past. They've already started to see that with the downturn in Iraq. Army's moving to a 9-month deployment, so there'll be less rotations as far as R&R programs and things of this nature, so there'll be less business in that area, which is just another example. But we're continuing to talk with the CEOs and their planning for the future. I am encouraged, and I do very much appreciate what the industry has done to modernize their fleet. About 80% is now modern aircraft, more fuel efficient, can carry more, can go farther. And we are deeply appreciative of that because that's a savings to all of us.
And I just want to point that out because, I mean, obviously one of the biggest craft carriers, Global Aviation, has declared bankruptcy as we speak. And I want to point out to you also that the Air Force over the last 5 years has spent $2.2 billion on strategic airlift on foreign non-craft carriers also. So it is something where, you know, take care of your own a lot of times. And I just wanted to make sure that you were aware of that and any actions you can do to help, you know, maximize the craft of our United States flagged aircraft would be greatly appreciated. So thank you.
Thanks, sir.
I yield back, Chairman.
Appreciate it. Admiral McRaven, I've got one last question for you. I noticed in the bios of the witnesses today that General Mattis had included the college from which he graduated. And even General Frazier is willing to admit that he is a graduate of Texas A&M. But I didn't see that on your bio. You're not embarrassed by your alma mater, are you, sir?
Sir, I'm absolutely not. I'm a proud graduate of the University of Texas.
Okay. I just recommend a little staff follow-up on some of that, perhaps.
Well, we will do that.
Thank you all, seriously, for being here, for your service to the country, and for all of those who serve in your commands for their service. We appreciate it, and with that, the hearing stands adjourned.
Thank you, sir.